Connie Martinson Talks Books. The reason a book is a classic is because whatever the story and the people in it are, it's universal. It's as universal if it was in 1860 as if it's in 2011. My guest today, Gabrielle Donnelly, has written The Little Women Letters. It's published by Simon & Schuster. Welcome, Gabrielle.
Hi, it's lovely to be here. Thank you for inviting
me. You're more than welcome. And I enjoyed reading the book because, what I said, a classic. And you have adapted, not really adapted, but you've taken people who are living now and taken how it resembles and is similar to Little Women.
Yeah, yes.
As well as giving letters that they might have written to each other from incidents in their lives.
Yes, yes.
Now, you got this assignment because you won a contest.
Well, I auditioned for it, in fact, which is not something writers usually do. But there's a wonderful editor in London called Lydia Newhouse, a wonderful young editor who was working at the time for English Penguin. And she had the idea of taking the great-great-granddaughter of Jo March from Little Women, placing her in a modern setting, obviously, and having her find some of her great-great-grandmother's letters to give a sort of backstage view of the Little Women story. And she auditioned various writers, I don't know how many, but I wrote a chapter and I got the job, which was delightful for me.
All right, now let me ask you, in order to do that, you had to do a lot of research.
Well, in a sense, I'd spent my life researching this.
Yes.
Because I've been reading Little Women all my life. I read it first when I was, I think, about nine. I fell in love with it and I've been reading, I read it as a child. I wanted to be part of that family. I became an adult, it became sort of comfort reading for me because there was always something there for me to look and love and enjoy. I fell in love with the characters. I wanted to be part of that family. So I'd been immersing myself in the book since I was 9 years old, which was a great start.
But I'm just curious, and I made a note to myself, what if you hadn't won? What if you hadn't won the test to write this book? You had all of that. What would you have done?
Oh, I'd have been quite sad, I think.
Yeah.
It was quite difficult to write the first chapter because I had to work on it hard enough to make it good, but I wasn't allowing myself to fall in love with the characters because I didn't know that I'd be spending time with them. I'd have gone on to do something else, I suppose the other people did, but I was very, very happy to spend my time doing this.
Okay, let's tell our friends about the family in London that you have. And the mother, of course, is American.
Yeah.
So we have Fee, who is the American mother, married to the Englishman David Atwater.
Yeah.
She's a therapist, and he's a travel editor, publisher, writer.
Yes, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Totally different occupations.
Well, the big thing about putting the 19th century marches into modern London is that, as Louisa May Alcott herself would have been delighted to know, women's place has changed very much. And Fee, the girl who is the great-granddaughter of Jo March, who in my imagination met an Englishman, married him and moved to London and raised three girls of her own.
And she had been a hippie. She had been really a free soul before she did it. Now they're married 20 years and they have three daughters.
30 years because their oldest daughter is 28. Yeah.
Emma, whose real name had been Josephine.
Yes.
And she's engaged to marry Matthew.
Yes.
Then there's Lulu, who's 24.
Yeah.
She's a brilliant girl.
Yeah.
She really is your Josephine.
Absolutely, absolutely, yeah.
And she is also quite a cook, quite a chef.
Yes, but that's just something
Not much money working for an antique store.
Yeah.
And she rooms with a very wealthy lady, Charlie.
Yes.
Who has said, look, forget money, I have it, I want you to be my roommate.
Yeah.
And then there is Sophie.
Yes.
The beautiful blonde Sophie, who is your Amy.
Absolutely, absolutely.
No Beth, because Beth dies in Little Women.
Beth dies in Little Women, and one of the big differences, of course, between the world of the Marches and the world of the modern Atwaters is that the Atwaters have medicine. Beth died of scarlet fever, which she wouldn't have done today. And I couldn't bring myself to create a new Beth who was cured. Mm-hmm. Because that would be wrong, that would be disrespectful to the real Beth,
yeah.
who of course was, the fictional Beth, of course, was modelled on a real life sister of Louisa May Alcott, who sadly did contract scarlet fever and die soon afterwards.
What's interesting is how you have written it. There are elements of the original in this group, but it's not verbatim.
No. Well,
so that when you have Meg writing, not Meg, Jo writing to Amy in Europe, there's nobody who, Lulu, who is Jo here, is interested in that the others are. Because Sophie is one of those girls, like in Amy, everybody falls in love with.
Yes, yes, she's very charming.
Yeah.
Yes. Well, of course, the world for the modern girls is very different. I mean, I have at one point Jo, the old Jo writing to Amy, who's gone to Europe probably for a year. These days, girls in London can get on a plane and be in Lord knows where. They go for a weekend to all sorts of wonderful places. I'm jealous of that.
In the old days, when she's writing to Amy and Laurie is there, she thinks Laurie's going to be her beau at the time.
Well,
Jo.
No, in fact, the readers very much wanted Laurie, the original Little Women readers, very much wanted Laurie and Jo to marry. A lot of them did. But Louisa May Alcott dug her heels in and said, I'm going to marry him off to Amy, which some people find difficult. I actually think it was a very good match because they're both, in the nicest way, very worldly. They're both sophisticated. They're both charming.
And they're pretty.
They're pretty, yes, indeed. Yes, Jo, we all loved Jo in Little Women, but I think she could be quite difficult to get along with. There's a scene in Good Wives where Laurie proposes to Jo and she says, we'd never work out, I'm too difficult. So I'm glad he and Amy had a nice
I would say, too,
marriage.
That you have brought it up to the future when you have the Emma living with Matthew. And
oh,
they're
yes.
not married. It's before they're married.
Absolutely, absolutely. And nobody thinks twice about it. I'd far rather live now than then, because there are many more opportunities.
But even as a modern marriage, not all of them run smoothly.
No, they don't.
And unfortunately, Lulu is in the house.
Yes.
When she hears her father talking to another woman.
Well, I don't want to give any spoilers, but there is a bit of a bump in the modern marriage. One of the most challenging parts for me in writing the Little Women letters was to bring Marmee into the future, because in Little Women, Marmee is perfect.
Yeah.
She has an answer for everything. She's wise, she's good, she's kind. And that suited that generation.
Mm-hmm.
But modern people, they can't read that, they can't take that, we don't believe that. So I had to make Fee fallible. And I had to find a way of showing that it's not necessarily easy to live with Fee all the time.
Yeah.
It all has a happy ending, happily, but I just wanted to hint at that a little bit.
Yeah, and she's rightfully angry.
Yes.
She has a temper.
Yes.
And he says, I'm not needed anymore.
Well,
and I thought how true that is of so many marriages, and that is why many people, you suddenly say, they're getting a divorce after 35 years.
Well, in fact, this was not so much, frankly, about the state of their marriage as it was about the fact that I've always found interesting that he was the only man in a house full of women. Now, I happened to come from a family of four brothers, so I was the only girl. And it's a rather strange situation sometimes to be the only one of your gender. However much people love you, you're always slightly on your own. And if you notice in Little Women, father was off. He was physically off. Away, absent.
Yeah, he was in the army,
And in fact, he was being a chaplain to the people in the war. And when he came back, he was referred to as being very wise. But you don't see much of him. So it was a bit of a challenge to translate that into the modern day. Louisa May Alcott's own father was a very interesting character, Bronson Alcott. He was a visionary, and he was ahead of his times in many ways.
He was an abolitionist too, wasn't he?
But that was one of the least controversial parts of him, frankly. He didn't make a living for the family. He was always, no one seems to know, including certainly me, no one can figure out whether he was this wonderful visionary prophet or just a complete lunatic. He didn't see it necessary to provide for his family. And I think Louisa had a quite complicated relationship with him, which is why she quite specifically had the Little Women father absent. And I made a point of, in many ways, making David, whom I was very fond of, in many ways he's got his own little world going on.
Yeah.
He has his funny little in jokes that he shares with himself.
And his great joke, of course, is Claire.
Oh God, yes.
Who is Claire?
Claire is his fantasy wife, who is all the things that Fee is not. And he teases her about it, and it's just a little goofy joke. But it's to say that he's a modern man who's married to a very, very dynamic woman, and that's not always easy.
The house with them is not a graduate student, because he has a PhD.
Yeah.
And in a way, you sort of think, what is this man living as a fairly inexpensive student, but he's not a student, really, living in this boarding house to him.
That's what you have to read the book to find out. That's one of the things.
Yes. Especially where you suddenly think, there's going to be a romance for Lulu.
Well, you never know. You never know. I will say that Laurie, who was the one who didn't marry Lulu, Laurie has turned this book into a girl. She's Charlie, who, if you notice, is the rich girl. It was very convenient for the March sisters, in narrative terms, to have a rich family living next door, because it meant they had the poverty, but they had resources when they need. It was a very interesting and convenient narrative device.
Aha. Uh-huh.
And I've done a modern twist on that and put that into Charlie, who is called by her last name. Her real name is Alfreda Alessandra Fitzcharles, and she's called Charlie, just as Laurie is Theodore Lawrence, called Laurie. And she gives Lulu a place to live, and she takes
but a good place to
very
live.
Very good place to live. She's like, I wouldn't mind having a friend like Charlie. Yeah.
We all wouldn't. Yeah. And then, of course, there was always the rich aunt.
Oh, yes.
And in this case, it's Aunt Amy.
Yes, indeed. Who is very much based on Aunt March. And she comes to visit at one point, and there are various ups and downs when she comes to visit. I grew quite fond of her.
Well, she changes too within the book, because...
She faces her own personal challenges. And as Fee explains to the girls, she didn't have it easy. Aunt Amy, in the book, is the great-granddaughter of Amy March. And if you read the book, Amy and Laurie, they were a rich couple. And I imagine that the family would carry on being rich and rather more conventional. And I had my picture of Aunt Amy is of a woman who is now about 70, who was raised at a very difficult time for young women, the 40s and the 50s, when you really, I mean, Fee grew up in the 70s feminism was starting.
Women.
Yeah, but if you were that 15, 20 years earlier, you had it
enormous,
much tougher.
Yeah, much tougher,
I think. I feel for the women of that generation. Yeah. I mean, my mother she was older than that. She was born in 1920, and she saw changes that were not available to her. I think it's, And I have made a point in this book of having Fee look at her daughters who are in their 20s and say, I'm so delighted that you've got all these opportunities, and let's celebrate this, because opportunities like this for women are very rare. I mean, when I was growing up, we were slightly second-class citizens. Mm. These days, girls don't even think twice about them.
Where did you go to college?
I went to London University.